My name is Silvia Ramos, and I'm a lecturer in materials at the School of Physical Sciences. And I would like to start my presentation today by giving you a very biased view of history. If you think about where we started as humans, the first tools that we used were stone. And what we did in that case was manipulate the stones and make them into something that we could use as tools. And it helped us a lot to hunt better or to develop agriculture in a more efficient way. It was a very big step forward when we started using tools. A bit later on, we developed the ability to make our own materials. And we started with metals and glass, things that we could melt. And that again allowed us to produce new tools, but it also allowed us to make things that we couldn't do before, like put windows into our houses to keep the cold out. It allowed us to make little metallic durable blocks of letters that then allowed us to print books in large numbers. And that was definitely a changing step in the development of humanity. Later on, we discovered fossil fuels, and that led us to the Industrial Revolution. But not only that, it also gave us the chemistry of carbon. And if you look around and you see the amount of things that you manipulate in your everyday life that are made out of plastic, you will realize how big an impact that had on the way we live. More recently, people did research on semiconductors and learned a lot about silicon, and that allowed us to start developing things like the computers that we have nowadays. That amount of computing power has changed the way we live. We have smartphones that we carry in our pockets. Information is at our fingertips all the time. What's coming next is something that, well, we'll have to see, but we know already that there are a number of challenges that are materials related that we really need to solve, and we are working on them. So one of them is, how do we store this amount of information that we are generating? And material scientists are already working on finding new ways of storing information in solid state materials with a very high density, so you can carry a lot of that information in your pocket. There are other things like renewable energy sources. There are a number of materials related challenges there too. So, for example, how do we store all the electricity that one can produce using the renewable energy sources? Renewable energy sources is not something that you can control and just produce in a stream slowly, that you can tune to the needs. The wind is there whenever it is there. And the key is to find a good way to store all of that electricity when it's produced so that we can use it when we need it. So that's already a challenge. That's something that we have to deal with. If you think about longer term energy sources like fusion reactors, one of the main problems that they have is how they can contain the reaction that they generate. They produce a little sun in their labs. Holding that confined is not an easy challenge, and that's something where materials again will have to play a role to allow us to solve that problem. The conduction of electricity. We lose a lot of energy when we take the electricity from whenever it is produced to the place where we are going to use it. And maybe superconductors will hold the answer to that, because they are very good materials to transfer electricity without losing energy in the process. So all of those are there, but the one thing that I would bet is true, because the history of science tells us that, is that there is somebody out there currently working on a material that will just change the way we live. And they won't be thinking about it, because the applications is something that they can't predict at this stage, but they will be there. We have examples of that. The people that were working on the semiconductors were not thinking about Wikipedia or CD in three dimensions, cinema in three dimensions, or the amazing tools that we have to visualize inside the body at the hospitals that depend on massive amounts of computing power. And yet, they wouldn't be there if they hadn't done that work. So that is what drove me into material science. We are interested in materials because of their properties. I have three examples there related to the research that I do. Graphite, a compass, and an image of the inside of the reactor vessel of a fusion reactor. Graphite is a black material, doesn't look particularly interesting. Iron is what goes into the needle of the compass. And alloys, niobium titanium, for example, is what goes into making big magnets in a place like Jet, which is what is pictured in there. We are not interested in these materials because they look particularly interesting. We are interested in them because of their properties, because what they allow us to do. And that is what material science is concerned with. We have two questions. The first one is, what are the properties that these materials have? The second question is, why? And answering these two questions is what drives materials research. Why do we want to do this? Well, I mean, curiosity in a scientist is something that cannot be underestimated. If there is something out there that you don't understand, you will try to find an answer. But also, if you look at the research in materials from a broader perspective, is what allows us to build the next generation of things. If you understand why this thing has an interesting property, then maybe in the future you can either make that better or make something slightly different based on the same principles. So that is what we are after. So how do we do this? There are many ways of measuring the properties of matter. Many of them can be found in the labs around here. You can measure the conductivity of a material if you want to use it for transferring electricity. You can measure how much energy you can store in it if you want to use it as a battery. There are very different ways. I'm interested in looking at a microscopic level. I want to know what happens inside the material and why these properties come about from that perspective. What happens inside? Often you would use a microscope to do that sort of work. And one has to be careful because, well, it works very often, but anybody that has eaten an orange knows that what happens inside a material is not necessarily the same as what happens outside. So that is something that one has to bear in mind. How do we solve that problem? There are many ways. One could be a bit brutal and use a hammer, and then you make the inside the outside, and you look at it that way. That is one possibility, and it works. It often works, but it has two potential problems. One of them is that materials have a tendency to reorganize their surfaces. So once you've opened it, probably it's going to rearrange themselves in a way that might not be representative of the bulk again. So we go back to the problems with the orange. The other thing is that quite frequently, producing these new materials takes a lot of effort, and producing these samples take a lot of effort. I work with single crystals. I have a collaborator that might have spent weeks or months producing those single crystals. Taking a hammer to them might not be exactly what he would like me to do at that point. Also, there is value in keeping your same samples to do more than one measurement, because that is something that allows you to correlate information. You might be measuring the magnetism of the material, and you might want to measure as well how it's changing in volume with temperature. And you might want to see if the change in the magnetism and the change in volume happens at the same temperature, and that will give you information about what's going on inside the material. So keeping your samples in one piece has value. Sometimes the samples are historical artifacts, and you simply would not be allowed to break them. But you know, there are several reasons why it's important to develop tools to be able to look inside the materials without actually destroying them. And if we are going to start looking for alternative methods of measurement, potentially more complicated, one would want to find exactly what you need to do and at what scale you want to work. When you're going to try to understand the properties of materials, most of the time you're going to be interested in a scale that has to do with the atomic arrangement, so the separation of the atoms within the sample, and the electrons in that material. And if we go back to my three examples from earlier on, graphite is useful to write because your atoms are arranged in layers, and when you put your pen to a paper, the different layers are going to slide and leave a trace on the paper, and that's what makes them useful for writing. So once you understand that the atoms in that material are layered, you can understand the properties. The second example was a magnetic material. In that case, what's happening is that the electrons are organizing their spins in a long range order way, in this case parallel to each other, and that will give it this special property. So again, if you understand and you can measure this arrangement of the spins of the electrons, you would understand the property of the material. Superconductors, in that case, the electrons are pairing, and that allows them to move undisturbed across the material, and it allows them to behave as they had, as if that material had no resistivity. So again, if you understand what the electrons are doing, you understand the properties of the material. So what type of scale are we talking about here? How separated are atoms in a material? So typically they are about 1 angstrom apart. And that is about 10 to the minus 10 meters. And that is very small. So if you think about it, you would be looking at 1 millimeter, and then you think about something that is 1 million times smaller than 1 millimeter, and then you make it 10 times smaller than that, and that is the distance between atoms. So it's really, really a small length scale that you're looking at. So when we think about methods of looking inside a material at those scales, we have to find a probe that will go inside the material, because think back on the orange. You want them to be able to give us information at a very small scale, and that means that they are going to be very small probes. And you want something that is going to go in and is going to come out, and you're going to interrogate them when they are out to try to find out what they saw when they were inside. So that is the general idea. That's what we are after. In condensed matter, we use 3 types of probes to do that. We use synchrotron X-rays, we use neutrons, and we use muons to do that. And they have exactly those properties. They're very small, they will go inside the material, they will have a look around, and then when they come out, we can interrogate them and find out what they saw. They have their own specialties, that's why we have 3. So electrons would be better to look at with synchrotron X-rays in general. If you are after atomic positions, probably the neutrons would be a better option. Long-range magnetic order, you would also be working with neutrons possibly. Short-range magnetic order, you could use muons instead. So each of them are complementary, you get different information from them. And my job would be to decide which one of them is suitable to try to understand a particular material. Where do we find these things? We find them in large facilities. There are big labs, they're a big investment in resources, they are a big effort to run. How did they start? How we found out that these things could be used if we produce them in one of these big machines? They are really an offshoot of research that was done for particle physics in the 60s. Around that time, they were producing the synchrotron sources, they were producing neutrons. Eventually, they decided that they had understood what they wanted to know at that scale and at that energy scale, and they needed bigger machines and they needed higher energies. So what happened at that point was that the condensed matter physicists came along and said, well, actually, this could be quite useful to us if we just tweak them a little. And that's what happened. So many of those older particle accelerators were recycled into sources for X-rays or neutrons or muons that were used by the condensed matter community. Later on, it has been seen that they are so useful that the governments in different countries are either building their own sources or grouping a number of efforts into the building of one big facility that is shared by many countries. So they are purpose-built and they are tweaked to do exactly this sort of work, but their origins were humbler than that. The 2 examples that I've got here are the national sources and at the Rutherford Appleton lab in the UK, and the European common access sources that are at the ILL in Grenoble. Let me briefly tell you how we run these things. So there is one big machine to produce a very small probe, and they produce them in very large numbers. So what happens at that point is that they can be split into fractions of this big source, and each of these bunch of, say, X-rays or neutrons or muons can be directed to different experiments. And normally what happens is that you would have 20, 40 experiments running at the same time. So each one of those lines in that example there would be a different experiment that has been prepared and tweaked and optimized to do a particular type of measurement for a particular type of material. My job would be, once I've decided I'm going to start a certain material, to decide which ones of these instruments would be suitable to find the answers that I need, because not all of them will be. So that is the first step that a material scientist specialized in large facility measurements as I am, we do, to look specifically at the problem at hand and choose which are the best tools to try to get the answers that we need. These places are very expensive to run and access is competitive. So what is not possible is for one of my collaborators to say, I've got this new material, I think it's going to be interesting, just bring it around to a synchrotron, say, and measure it in several places. It doesn't work like that. Access is competitive. And before we get access to any of these instruments, a lot of background work has happened and previous characterization has been done. So I'm really quite lucky because there is a certain amount of luck in choosing a system or a problem that is going to be interesting and how rewarding it is. In science, it's always like that. You don't know the answer before you start. But a lot of the previous screening of what is going to be interesting is done by my collaborators. By the time they come to me, normally the questions are quite well defined, and I'm grateful for that. What happens then? So once you have a material that you know you want to look at a microscopic level, what happens? The first thing that you need to do is decide what type of measurements you are going to do. Then there is a proposal to be written. Then an external committee of experts looks at it and decides how many of the proposals of that round are actually going to be awarded access to these places. When you do, you have to prepare the samples, you have to get a team of experimenters that is going to come with you to the experiment and ensure that these measurements run 24 hours a day for a number of days, however many you've been awarded. And then there is beam time, which is a very intense measuring time. And you come back and there is data analysis to be done. So all the process from the time when you have a problem and a question to the time where you actually have the answer can take many months, sometimes years, if the first experiment doesn't really give you what you are looking for. So it's a slightly different way of doing experimental science than it would be if my lab was just next to my office. So just to conclude my talk today, the first thing that I would like to emphasize is that materials are very important for human development. They've been since the beginning. And the research that we do hopefully will open doors to ways of doing things and improvements in our lives that will be substantial and will make life better. So there are many scientists that work on the research of materials. Some of us are interested in looking at the microscopic scale of things. And in order to do that, we use these large facilities, which are a big commitment in terms of resources, but they also hold some of the key tools for us to understand the properties that we are interested in. Thank you for listening.